Hello, all you psychedelic freaks out there, maniacs of the macabre, fiends of the fright. It's your humble host of horror, Benjamin Duto, with the Horror Heathen YouTube channel and the South Jersey Horror Podcast. Today, on this episode, I am talking to Akasha Villalobos. I hope I pronounced your last name right, because if I didn't, I'm sorry. My last name is butchered all the time, so I'm like, yeah, whatever, I get used to it by now. Anyway, she plays the role of Allie Larkin in the movie Trip. So, distributed by Terror Films, one of my all-time favorite distributors of all time, and those who have not seen this movie, it's a fantastic psychedelic mind spank, and I love it. I love psychedelic mind spank movies because it gets you thinking, your brain starts moving in motion, and at the end, you ask yourself, what the fuck did I just watch? So it's one of those kind of movies. Part of my language, I'm sorry, I should have told you, I should give you a heads up. I do cuss a little bit in my interviews because I'm sorry. If you're offended, I'll stop. Just let me know right now.
I'm not offended.
Okay. I'm a veteran, so I'm going to cuss. I'm sorry. It's just no filter between here and here. It just comes out. I'm sorry.
That's awesome.
Anyway, no. I will do my best to keep it down to a minimum. So, however, the movie is great. As I was saying, it's a psychedelic mind spank. Following her daughter's suicide, a grief-stricken mother is visited by an unconventional therapist who offers a hallucinogenic drug that will allow communion with the dead. Sounds a lot like, you know, Sixth Sense and the Babadook, mm-hmm. and a lot of good references in this movie when it comes to like the paranormal, the undead. Anyway, desperate to understand her daughter's psyche, she accepts the offer and soon finds herself terrorized by her daughter's identical experiences, written and directed by Neil McKay. I'm going to get off my soapbox now. I've already talked too much. So please give a warm welcome and a round of applause to Akasha Villalobos. Thank you for joining me. How the hell are you doing?
I'm good. Thanks for inviting me.
My pleasure. Absolute honor. I love talking to actors about the roles of the film because I want a better understanding of how the experience is for you and what kind of emotions you have to put yourself through, especially this kind of movie. I mean, Jesus Christ. I mean, if I took a drug and started seeing the undead people, I'm like, I'm done. Just put me out of my misery. I'm screwed. I'm done. So anyway, to get more know more about you, could you please tell the audience a little bit about yourself and how your acting career started?
Well, my father was an actor in the Dallas area. And so my first play was when I was four. I didn't have the moment of like asking to act or wanting it. It was kind of just already there in my life. And I was like, yeah, that's what people in my family do. Let's do it. But there was a time around 17 where I was like, I want to do this for a career. And then I ended up abandoning that after high school and I went to film school and then I became a teacher. And then and at that point, I'd only done theater because that's really what was available where I grew up in DFW. And then around 2011 is when I was in Austin and they have a film scene and my husband and I found out how to find the auditions and we started doing it. And that's been what we've been doing ever since. So
that's awesome. That's great. Fantastic. A lot of people don't think that acting in theater doesn't help, which I know for sure, for a fact, it does help. It's experience. So people always ask me, like, how do actors learn from playing in theater? I'm like, well, they're acting for one, and they still have to memorize the lines. And they're on stage in front of thousands of people, which may be different, you know, from being behind the camera. But hey, it's still experience. Mm-hmm. It's still there. It's learning. You're learning how to act, but in front of a big crowd. I was in drama club for 2 years in high school. I absolutely hated it. I mean, I would always forget my lines, and I'd stutter and I'd turn red, get embarrassed. I'm like, I told the director, like, nope, I'm done. He's like, give me the role with no lines, and I'll be happy. Okay.
Yeah.
And then I want to be in Vinny in Greece. I'm like, are you kidding me? I have to memorize all these lines, all these lyrics to a song. I'm like, this is not going to happen. But sure shit, it turned out just fine. I did pretty good. So for a high school student who's 17 years old, whatever. I mean, whatever is done, it's done. So I was also in Cats, which had no speaking role whatsoever. Perfect. So I was happy with that. I crawled around the stage like a cat. Good enough for me. I mean,
that works.
Anyway, your character in this movie in Trip, a grieving mother of a daughter's suicide, and which a suicide I have never seen in a movie before. Very creative, by the way. Someone taking their eyeballs out. I'm like, what the hell just happened?
Yeah.
So I'm like, this is nuts. So aside from what people see in the movie, can you describe your character's personality in your own words?
Well, we really kind of focused on the agoraphobia that she was now experiencing. And you know, it's maybe she had a, I believe she was a realist. What was she? No, she was a therapist, right? It's been several years, forgive me, since we shot that. But yeah, so she, you know, had a healthy relationship with, you know, people and life. And after that traumatic event, really spiraled and had an issue just how everyone around her was just acting normal, like had gone back to normal life. And that just didn't seem possible or appropriate for the character of Allie. And so it just really just, she just kind of cut all that out, cut all of her friends and experiences out and just revert, you know, just went inside and just couldn't even, I don't think could find the motivation to want to get back out. It's kind of like, it's like the survivor's guilt a little bit. It's like, I don't want to get back to a normal life. I don't want to get back to happy. Because that does a disservice to the person that I lost. I need to be broken because she's gone. So that's where she was at. And then, you know, throughout the movie, there's a dance of trying to come back out maybe and finding hope with the psychedelic liquid that's presented to her. And then, you know, I don't know how much you like spoilers or how much we want to avoid them. Yeah.
Let it rip. Go for it.
Things. Her finding herself in the same psychosis that her daughter did, which led her daughter to the suicide. And so that was, just trauma and horror ensues.
I get it. I understand. My grandmother passed away a couple years ago and we were so close. So I get it. When she passed away, I crumbled. I'm like, I don't want to see the world right now. Leave me alone. So I'm like, I was a hermit for 3 weeks in my house. I didn't go anywhere. I was teleworking. It was during COVID, so I was teleworking home.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I don't want to go anywhere. I mean, I didn't shave. I didn't do nothing. Well, my beard, I don't shave, obviously, but, you know, my beard was a lot. I had a Viking beard going, so it was nuts.
Yeah, the COVID beard, yeah.
I look like a homeless person going to my house, okay? And it was just, anyway, it was in the past. I mean, it's whatever it is. I mean, but I get it. I've been in that situation before. It was a dark time. And it's very hard for people who are grieving to just move on sometimes. I mean, mm-hmm. I talked to a mother who lost her son, and she didn't talk to anyone for months. I mean, she just closed up for months, and it took me a long time to get through to her. I was calling her every day, you know, sending her text messages to check up on her, see how she's doing, stop by her house. I would cook meals for her and drop off flowers. So I knocked on the door. She didn't answer. I just laid down on the front step. I hope someone doesn't steal her food. I'm sorry. I mean, I slid her a hot stove with this thing. Please don't steal the food. I mean, anyway, I've been there. Yeah. I get it. I can relate. So this role, typically, you read the script and you're thinking, oh, my God, what am I getting into? So how did you mentally prepare for this role? I mean, knowing what was going to happen.
Well, that's a little bit of an interesting story. I turned it down because it was too dark.
Really?
Twice. Yeah. Neil found my reel, and it was an old reel, and he was like, I don't even, he just cold messaged me or emailed me and was like, hi, I found your reel. I'm new to the Austin area. I don't know if you're still acting, but wondering if you're interested in this. And I met with him. I think maybe it was the other way around. But anyway, I read the script and I can't actually watch horror. It affects me too much. My fear response is so overwhelming that that fear will stick with me for so long that I cannot watch horror on a regular basis. And so even reading the script, and I wasn't pregnant yet with my second, but I had a young daughter. And I was like, I can't bring this energy into my house. Like, I can't embody this and then turn around and be with my kid. Like, this is strong. This is just like you said, psychosis. It's like, it's dark. It's paranormal. And I was like, I don't think I can go there, man. I'm really sorry. And he was like, okay. And they kept looking. And then he came back and he was like, I really want you to do it. What do you, could you maybe do it? And I think I said no again. And I was just like, I can't. And then he came back a third time. And I was like, maybe I can handle it, you know? And I tried and it was okay. It wasn't as bad as I had feared it would be. Because yeah, if not every actor works that way, where I do like to go and do some imagination work and really go try to feel the trauma that would have preceded, you know, the events or that happened concurrently during the movie. And so I did do that. And, you know, we had to definitely do that on set. And so it is, it's rough. And, but it also, it's interesting. It's not as bad as it seems. Like the anticipation of those kind of feelings can be worse than just being like, yeah, I'm in it now, but I'm still here, you know? So.
It's actually the third time. I want a trailer. I want a hot tub. I want a raise.
Here are my demands. Yeah.
I want a horse. I'm with this, I'm with a Cadillac, I'm with all this shit, okay? What? All right, let's just do it
that way. Instead of asking for a horse, yeah.
Anyway, it's fantastic. I'm glad you came back and did it. I really am. Because in the end of the movie, you gave it your all. I mean, your performance was grief-stricken, a grief-stricken mother who is naturally convincing. So, I mean, nevertheless, you deserve a standing ovation for this role. I mean, because it's the way it is. You did so well. I mean, it was fantastic. I was convinced. I'm like, shit, she's really getting into this role. I mean, give this woman an Oscar, for fuck's sake. Give her a damn Oscar.
Right.
So,
thank you. No.
So, I have a question. When your character is told by the other therapist to drink the, I call it psych juice. I don't know what it is. I dubbed it sure. Psych juice.
What was it called? I forgot the name of that flower, but yeah. Mm-hmm.
I dubbed it psych juice. So, and then you see Allie contemplating, like, what should I drink this? Should I not drink this? I mean, it looks like she's thinking, okay, this is very unorthodox for something like shit to have like this. And it seems like, but it also seems like Allie jumped in really quick to drink the psych juice. I mean, do you think she was even considering the ramifications of you know, drinking the psych juice?
Well, not negative ones. It's at this point, I don't think it was a lot to lose. Her life at that point was pretty empty and disconnected. And, you know, the hope of that's really the only thing that she can bring herself to want is the connection with her daughter. You know, like she can't want a good life for herself without her daughter. Cause like, you know, that survival's guilt was so strong and, it's like, it doesn't really matter if it goes wrong. Like who cares, you know, kill me. I don't care. You know, like, you know, drive me insane. I'm already insane. I mean, I don't care, you know, it was worth a try. And I don't think she was like, I think this is going to work. It's just like, fine. You say it's going to work, then work. I don't know. You know, who cares? Do it or don't.
Screw it. Let's just ride a roller coaster, see where it goes. Right. I mean,
exactly. It's like, yeah, you do not care to stay where you are, you know, in life. And so I don't know, you know, she wasn't, you know, she does have some suicidal thoughts, but I think that is all after she starts taking the drink. So, but the depression was so deep and her life was just not worth salvaging particularly, you know. She wasn't doing anything and she wasn't trying to get anywhere like more positive at that point, in my opinion.
Honestly, I thought Ellie was going to chug the whole bottle the first time. Just the way she, I'm like, Jesus Christ,
yeah.
Slow down, lady. Save yourself for tomorrow. I mean.
Yeah. So a bad idea.
Did the juice taste funny? Was it actually enjoyable?
I think it was just tea, which I don't like tea.
No. Oh, wow. Okay.
I'm not a tea drinker. No, I think it was pretty, it was probably sweetened tea. So it was just fine.
Add some vodka to it, maybe a little flavor. I don't know.
Right.
Turn to a Long Island iced tea, for fuck's sake. I mean, if you enjoy it, if you're going to be upset, give some liquid courage, you know.
Right. Please. Yeah.
So were there any scenes too difficult for you to film in this movie, or is this easy, breezy, nice, cheesy?
Not too difficult to film. I mean, those are the fun ones, I guess. You know, it's why you do horror, is to go to 11, is to just hit experiences and the depths of humanity's emotions as far as we know they can go, you know. So otherwise you're not doing anything, you know. It's they're fine, but you know, they're not the, it is kind of yeah, the fun of it is to go deep, I guess. And so those are great.
Go big or go home.
You get to scream and throw things. I don't get to do that in my life, right? You know, I don't get to bludgeon anybody in my life. I never get to express anger like that in my life, right? You know, and so it's cathartic, and it's like, cool, I need to do that every few years, is hit something with a baseball bat and possibly hard, you know.
Honey, I love you, but let me know if this hurts. Hold real tight.
Yeah.
This may leave a bump, but I'm sorry. I'll pay for the hospital bill. So
come on, give me a break.
Take two Tylenol and call me in the morning. We'll see where it goes from there. Okay. Right. So the director's attention, not attention, intention, like the purpose of the movie, do you think it was to make the audience aware and mindful of suicide awareness? I mean,
yes, I think it was to investigate mental health issues. You know, a lot of horror, if not all horror, or most of it, is kind of a metaphor for the regular human experiences we have, and we are just going to exaggerate it all and jump into what we go through in a micro way, but we're going to look at it in a macro way in this movie. For kind of like, yeah, to explore. And yeah, absolutely, mental health and, like, you know, like the agoraphobia and guilt, you know. And this particular character, her being the therapist, she really like felt guilty about not being able to save her own daughter right in front of her face. So that's a huge failure, and that's a huge like, she just really let her daughter down by not, she was living with a therapist. She should have been safe. She should have been protected, right? You know, so these are all things we all go through. So a look at what we internalize about other people's actions and where, you know, what our responsibility could have been. So I do think, yeah, it wasn't, you know, I think that was a big part of the motivation to tell that story, is that look at mental health.
Exactly. I agree. Like, I'm a combat veteran, and I've been diagnosed with PTSD, anxiety, and depression, and all the perks that come with it. I mean, thanks to the military. I mean, it's just, it's tough. I get it. So,
yeah.
Thank you for answering that question. That's a great answer. I'm a huge advocate for mental health, and I help people sometimes. Like if I know like a friend of mine struggles, like, come on over. I have a few beers. Let's sit on my back patio and talk. And let's just, I'd rather sit through, you know, 30 minutes of what you have to say than, you know, say your eulogy at your funeral. I'd rather do that than, you know, attend your funeral. So it's great. But thank you for answering that. That's a really good, that was a very excellent answer.
There's another movie I did in like 2015 or so, 14 or 15, called Last Girl Standing, that was specifically a look at PTSD and the trauma response. So a lot of the directors, the horror directors I've been working with, are very interested in looking at these things through the lens of horror.
Exactly. And the funny part is, I did a study. I took a psychology class in college. It's funny how horror and depression, PTSD, kind of like go hand in hand. I mean, it's like a lot of people who have suffered from depression, like, are more into the horror genre than anything else. I mean, I can't sit down. I cannot sit down and watch a movie about wars. I can't do it. Like any kind of battles or wars or, like, you know, like Black Hawk Down, Saving Private Ryan, even like World War II shit, I can't sit and watch because I've experienced it twice. So I have to watch a comedy, and I'll watch a rom com if I have to. My fiance, if I have to. My fiance, come watch this movie. Okay, I guess. Is there any death scenes? Maybe. Then I'm not gonna watch it. I'm sorry. Okay.
Oh wow. Yeah. Yeah. So you were in actual combat, you said, right?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, I can only imagine. So, yeah.
And I mean, my PTSD has obviously calmed down a lot since I returned home, and I came back in 2009, which is a long time ago. But I still have, you know, jump scares every once in a while. I've gotten past the fireworks on 4th of July and New Year's Eve, but now it's just like if I watch certain movies, I get triggered. So I'm like, I can't watch this movie. I have to leave the room or I'll start crying. It's bizarre, but you know, yeah. Anyway, I'm sorry. I'm going way off topic here. This is not about me. This is about you. So anyway, a fun question I'd like to ask. If you could portray any other character in the movie, who would it be and why?
Let's see. Well, yeah, gosh. I guess, let's see. I'm running through the cast. I don't know. I like my role, but I guess I would go with Jan. Not just because of the gender, like if I could gender swap and be Michael. And then there's my daughter. But I think Jan, because she gets to have such a transformation and she gets to play two sides and has that transformation and such an underlying agenda. So I would go with that one. There just seems to be more of a multidimensional story to her experience and her expression.
That's great. I mean, I have a really off-the-wall question here. When is it every time a woman who sees, like, you know, I see dead people, and the husband's like, I think you're crazy. Get the fuck out of here. It's just, why does that happen every time?
Why don't you listen?
They never listen to anybody. So
that's a horror trope, isn't it? Yeah.
I'm sitting watching a movie like, I'm like, dude, listen to your wife. She's telling the truth. Or I'm going to get, when I'm reaching the screen, I'm going to smack the shit out of you. Listen to your wife, okay? Because it's going to happen.
Yes. If they would just give us a little bit of credit, you know, we could have a whole new story. So, yeah, that's the next script we need to write is the husband who's like, oh, my God, thanks for telling me. Let's get out of here.
Even though it's like one of the biggest cliches in horror movies, it's one of my biggest pet peeves. I'm like, just listen to these people, okay? If I tell my fiance I see dead people, she's going to believe me, okay? I guarantee she's going to believe me.
True. Yeah, we need some more healthy relationships. Yeah. Yes, a trusting marriage. You're right.
And she told me the same thing, like, honey, I'm calling a priest. I got some holy water. Let's get this shit done, okay? Because we're exercising the fuck out of this house, all right? All right, we're doing this. Okay?
Yeah, and moving. We're not going to, we're going to move, man. We're not going to sit here and fight the ghost. We're going to leave.
Yeah. This is the poltergeist, okay? We're doing it. We're leaving, all right?
We're gone. Yeah.
So I read your IMDb profile. And, oh, you're an award winner, by the way. Congratulations. That's a big thing, too, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
I meant to say that at the beginning, but now, duh. Anyway, that's a big thing to have. Be an award-winning actress. I mean, people are looking for you, like, towards you for, like, future roles. I don't know if that's true or not, but they should be. So. I mean.
Yeah.
I know a few directors. I was like, yo, dude, I know this friend of this really cool actress. Her name is, you know, Akasha Villalobos. Get a hold of her. Get her in the movie. She loves to act. Now, here's her fucking number, okay? She's on Facebook. Just get a hold of her, all right? She's good.
Thank you. Okay, you're my new agent, man. I like the way you pitch me. Yeah.
I know you're starring in a movie that is currently in post-production called 500 Fireflies. And can you tell the audience about that?
Yeah, I need to correct you. I'm not starring in that one. The and that one was shot a couple years ago. It is just still in post. I'm only in one scene of that, but my husband stars in that, and it does seem like it's going to be really special. But I'm only one scene. Just to clarify that one.
Still in the movie, it counts. I mean, in my opinion.
I haven't gotten to see a cut, but it is well made, well written, well acted, and we are looking forward to seeing that one. But yeah, go ahead.
So, what's the other one that's in production right now? I mean, I know there's another one too that's in production as well.
Nothing's being shot, or nothing's. Sometimes IMDb isn't updated and will say in production, but it's already like, or maybe it's in post and we're done. The most recent, there's one called Cerebral. That is my husband's movie and I'm in a scene of that one. But the one we did most recently is called Man Goes on Rant. And that was really great. That one is done and has had two festival screenings and so is in that phase of the movie journey, like looking for distribution. So that one is really wonderful and was a pleasure to be a part of.
So any other projects you come up you can tell about?
No, and I my youngest daughter is 7 years old. She's actually in Trip as young Samantha. And when I was pregnant with her, I stepped back a little bit. So now I only do a couple projects a year and I don't have anything in the works currently. I don't go out and get work. Like I don't actively search for work right now, but it comes from previous connections. So it's here and there, but that's kind of where I have a son now. So I'm staying home with him primarily and then doing work that trickles in as I usually describe it. So yeah.
Of course. Family comes first. I get it. I understand. So that's great.
That's
all the questions I have. I mean, unless there's something you want to add to your phenomenal role in this movie. Anything you want to brag about that can help promote on Facebook or social media?
Oh, you mean like a project? Man Goes on Rant is, if you have a festival and you're looking for an awesome, awesome movie, go get that. That's the one we're pushing right now. And I highly recommend it. But yeah, I'm sorry. Well, I am a part of a podcast called, what's it called? Strange Fantasy. And I just recorded several episodes of that. And so that, I'm not sure how long they take to come out though. So you could look for that Strange Fantasy podcast. I've done that for many years. So there's a bunch of episodes already available and then there's some upcoming are really cool.
What platform do you go through to do your podcast? I go through Anchor. So and it's uploaded immediately.
I'm not, I just record. It's not okay. Mine. And they, I think they have like 13 episodes. So they just get a mass of recordings from all over, I think, the world. They've got actors all over, and then they have to, you know, piece these into, all the, it's kind of like radio drama style. So all of us, and then they have to do the music and the sound effects. So it's, it seems like an overwhelming task, but they do it all. And they're currently, they're Travis and Ash are the names of the creators. They're currently creating them, editing wise. And so, yeah, I don't know how they do it, because they just turn it around year after year, but it's so much, and they do so many episodes, and they're good, and they're long. It's very impressive to me.
I have to check it out. I love listening to podcasts on the long drives. So,
oh yeah. Yeah, you should.
Write that down. I wrote it down just in case. So,
fancy. Yeah.
That's all the time we have. Thank you so much for joining me today. I really do appreciate you taking the time out. And yeah, it's fantastic talking to you about your role as Allie in the movie Trip. And you're a phenomenal actress. Keep it up. And you are great. I hope to see you in more movies. And I wish you nothing but the best in your career and a prosperous future.
Thank you. You same to you.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, psychedelic friends everywhere, the award-winning actress, Akasha Villalobos, round of applause. Thank you so much. And I will see you on the big screen. Take care.
Take care.